Call it catarization. It comes right in the middle of the range of what counts as that color. People remember whether they saw that color or not far better than if you show them a color at the boundary. And people will show that as a function of what language they speak. Taking a continua and you break it into pieces because it's easier to deal with the facts. Another example of it, here we have four objects, and as drawn here, simply because we have categories to describe the first three, do one of those tests of show people a bunch of shapes, and they come back an hour later and ask them, have you seen the shape before? And people are going to be far more accurate with this than whether they saw this or not, because we don't have a word for it. We don't have a word that's at all sort of analytical or some squiggly whatever. We don't have a clear-cut category. Thinking in categories makes it easier for us to remember stuff. And it makes it easier for us to evaluate stuff. So that's a classic sort of response that we have cognitively to complicated things. But there's a bunch of problems with categorical thinking. First example. And first one you can see from a realm of language differences, in that not only is there a continua of infinite number of wavelengths, there's a continua of sounds that humans can make. And different languages draw boundaries at different points as to what count as similar sounds or different sounds. There's like two different TH sounds in English, which apparently we're not very good at hearing, but there's other ones we aren't. And that will affect your ability to remember stuff, what word it was, depending on whether it is on a grammatically different boundary, whether it is a sound that sounds different to you or not. Example of this. Apparently, in Finnish, people do not differentiate between the sound of a B and the sound of a P. Whereas we have no trouble with that. But people from Finland do not make that differentiation. And I discovered this one day a number of years ago, where for reasons I don't even understand, I found myself needing to take testicular biopsies on baboons. Not having sort of learned that in junior high how you do that, I called up this guy in urology at the med school who happened to be Finnish, and I explained to him what I wanted to do, and he sort of took me through the paces and told me what thingy I needed to buy and that sort of stuff and holiday packages of those where you can get a dozen, and sort of telling me how to do that. And once we went through, he said, what I want you to do, the thing to do at this point, is get some practice. I want you to practice on a bear. What? He said, yeah, practice on a bear. And I said, are you kidding me? He said, I know it sounds crazy, but we have all the residents do that. It's a very good learning device. You know, either practice on a bear or an apple. Oh, here we see the dangers of making mistakes about differences between B and P under certain circumstances. So we see one of the dangers there, which is when you are paying too much attention to categories, you can't differentiate two facts that fall within the same category. Next example. Remember back at various points of anxiety during exams and such back when, where there was a world of difference between getting a 65 on a test and a 66 on a test. Not particularly different, but because there's this boundary drawn there between passing and failing, there is this dramatic differentiating we make. When you put up boundaries, you have trouble seeing how similar things are on either side of it. Next example, one additional problem that you get when you think categorically. And for this, everybody needs to turn over one of the pieces of paper, the paper you're going to hand in, the questionnaire. And what I'm going to do is read you a series of phone numbers, and I want you to write them down as accurately as possible. Okay, ready. 243-2649, 650-3260, 2565779, 832-2449, 2913-171, 2314-026, 593-2449, 7438-840. 831-5287. Okay, now what that exercise is, And no, that doesn't count towards the grade. What that will show, I'm sure, when in some obsessive burst of procrastination I actually look through the answers tonight, what it's going to show is the accuracy is going to tank the second you go from the phone number pattern. These color categorization, it comes right in the middle of the range of what counts as that color. People remember whether they saw that color or not far better than if you show them a color at the boundary. And people will show that as a function of what language they speak. Taking a continua and you break it into pieces because it's easier to deal with the facts. Another example of it, here we have four objects, and as drawn here, simply because we have categories to describe the first three, do one of those tests of show people a bunch of shapes, and they come back an hour later and ask them, have you seen the shape before? And people are going to be far more accurate with this than whether they saw this or not, because we don't have a word for it. We don't have a word that's at all sort of analytical or some squiggly whatever. We don't have a clear-cut category. Thinking in categories makes it easier for us to remember stuff, and it makes it easier for us to evaluate stuff. So that's a classic sort of response that we have cognitively to complicated things. But there's a bunch of problems with categorical thinking. First example, and first one you can see from a realm of language differences, in that not only is there a continua of infinite number of wavelengths, there's a continua of sounds that humans can make. And different languages draw boundaries at different points as to what count as similar sounds or different sounds. There's like two different TH sounds in English, which apparently we're not very good at hearing, but there's other ones we aren't. And that will affect your ability to remember stuff, what word it was, depending on whether it is on a grammatically different boundary, whether it is a sound that sounds different to you or not. Example of this. Apparently, in Finnish, people do not differentiate between the sound of a B and the sound of a P. Whereas we have no trouble with that. But people from Finland do not make that differentiation. And I discovered this one day a number of years ago, where for reasons I don't even understand, I found myself needing to take testicular biopsies on baboons. Not having sort of learned that in junior high how you do that, I called up this guy in urology at the med school who happened to be Finnish. And I explained to him what I wanted to do. And he sort of took me through the paces and told me what thingy I needed to buy and that sort of stuff and holiday packages of those where you can get a dozen, and sort of telling me how to do that. And once we went through, he said, what I want you to do, the thing to do at this point, is get some practice. I want you to practice on a bear. I said, what? He said, yeah, practice on a bear. And I said, are you kidding me? He said, I know it sounds crazy, but we have all the residents do that. It's a very good learning device. You know, either practice on a bear or an apple. Oh. Here we see the dangers of making mistakes about differences between B and P under certain circumstances. So we see one of the dangers there, which is when you are paying too much attention to categories, you can't differentiate two facts that fall within the same category. Next example. Remember back at various points of anxiety during exams and such back when, where there was a world of difference between getting a 65 on a test and a 66 on a test. Not particularly different, but because there's this boundary drawn there between passing and failing, there is this dramatic differentiating we make. When you put up boundaries, you have trouble seeing how similar things are on either side of it. Next example, one additional problem that you get when you think categorically. And for this, everybody needs to turn over one of the pieces of paper, the paper you're going to hand in, the questionnaire. And what I'm going to do is read you a series of phone numbers, and I want you to write them down as accurately as possible. Okay, ready. 243-2649, 650-3260, 2565-779, 832-2449, 2-913-171, 2314-026, 593-2449, 7438-840. 831-5287. Okay, now what that exercise is, And no, that doesn't count towards the grade. What that will show, I'm sure, when in some obsessive burst of procrastination I actually look through the answers tonight, what it's going to show is the accuracy is going to tank the second you go from the phone number pattern. These color categorization, it comes right in the middle of the range of what counts as that color. People remember whether they saw that color or not far better than if you show them a color at the boundary. And people will show that as a function of what language they speak. Taking a continua and you break it into pieces because it's easier to deal with the facts. Another example of it, here we have four objects, and as drawn here, simply because we have categories to describe the first three, do one of those tests of show people a bunch of shapes, and they come back an hour later and ask them, have you seen the shape before? And people are going to be far more accurate with this than whether they saw this or not, because we don't have a word for it. We don't have a word that's at all sort of analytical or some squiggly whatever. We don't have a clear-cut category. Thinking in categories makes it easier for us to remember stuff, and it makes it easier for us to evaluate stuff. So that's a classic sort of response that we have cognitively to complicated things. But there's a bunch of problems with categorical thinking. First example, and first one you can see from a realm of language differences, in that not only is there a continuum of infinite number of wavelengths, there's a continuum of sounds that humans can make. And different languages draw boundaries at different points as to what count as similar sounds or different sounds. There's like two different TH sounds in English, which apparently we're not very good at hearing, but there's other ones we are. And that will affect your ability to remember stuff, what word it was, depending on whether it is on a grammatically different boundary, whether it is a sound that sounds different to you or not. Example of this. Apparently, in Finnish, people do not differentiate between the sound of a B and the sound of a P. Whereas we have no trouble with that. But people from Finland do not make that differentiation. And I discovered this one day a number of years ago, where for reasons I don't even understand, I found myself needing to take testicular biopsies on baboons. Not having sort of learned that in junior high how you do that, I called up this guy in urology at the med school who happened to be Finnish, and I explained to him what I wanted to do, and he sort of took me through the paces and told me what thingy I needed to buy and that sort of stuff and holiday packages of those where you can get a dozen, and sort of telling me how to do that. And once we went through, he said, what I want you to do, the thing to do at this point, is get some practice. I want you to practice on a bear. I said, what? He said, yeah, practice on a bear. And I said, are you kidding me? He said, I know it sounds crazy, but we have all the residents do that. It's a very good learning device. You know, either practice on a bear or an apple. Oh. Here we see the dangers of making mistakes about differences between B and P under certain circumstances. So we see one of the dangers there, which is when you are paying too much attention to categories, you can't differentiate two facts that fall within the same category. Next example. Remember back at various points of anxiety during exams and such back when, where there was a world of difference between getting a 65 on a test and a 66 on a test. Not particularly different, but because there's this boundary drawn there between passing and failing, there is this dramatic differentiating we make. When you put up boundaries, you have trouble seeing how similar things are on either side of it. Next example, one additional problem that you get when you think categorically. And for this, everybody needs to turn over one of the pieces of paper, the paper you're going to hand in the questionnaire. And what I'm going to do is read you a series of phone numbers, and I want you to write them down as accurately as possible. Okay, ready. 243-2649, 650-3260, 2565-779, 832-2449, 2-913-171, 2314-026, 593-2449, 7438-840. 831-5287. Okay, now what that exercise is, And no, that doesn't count towards the grade. What that will show, I'm sure, when in some obsessive burst of procrastination I actually look through the answers tonight, what it's going to show is the accuracy is going to tank the second you go from the phone number pattern. These concatenation. It comes right in the middle of the range of what counts as that color. People remember whether they saw that color or not far better than if you show them a color at the boundary. And people will show that as a function of what language they speak. Taking a continua and you break it into pieces because it's easier to deal with the facts. Another example of it, here we have four objects, and as drawn here, simply because we have categories to describe the first three, do one of those tests of show people a bunch of shapes, and they come back an hour later and ask them, have you seen the shape before? And people are going to be far more accurate with this than whether they saw this or not, because we don't have a word for it. We don't have a word that's at all sort of analytical, or some squiggly whatever. We don't have a clear-cut category. Thinking in categories makes it easier for us to remember stuff, and it makes it easier for us to evaluate stuff. So that's a classic sort of response that we have cognitively to complicated things. But there's a bunch of problems with categorical thinking. First example. And first one you can see from a realm of language differences, in that not only is there a continuum of infinite number of wavelengths, there's a continua of sounds that humans can make. And different languages draw boundaries at different points as to what count as similar sounds or different sounds. There's like two different TH sounds in English, which apparently we're not very good at hearing, but there's other ones we are. And that will affect your ability to remember stuff, what word it was, depending on whether it is on a grammatically different boundary, whether it is a sound that sounds different to you or not. Example of this. Apparently, in Finnish, people do not differentiate between the sound of a B and the sound of a P. Whereas we have no trouble with that. But people from Finland do not make that differentiation. And I discovered this one day a number of years ago, where for reasons I don't even understand, I found myself needing to take testicular biopsies on baboons. Not having sort of learned that in junior high how you do that, I called up this guy, urology, at the med school, who happened to be Finnish. And I explained to him what I wanted to do. And he sort of took me through the paces and told me what thingy I needed to buy and that sort of stuff and holiday packages of those where you can get a dozen, and sort of telling me how to do that. And once we went through, he said, what I want you to do, the thing to do at this point, is get some practice. I want you to practice on a bear. I said, what? He said, yeah, practice on a bear. And I said, are you kidding me? He said, I know it sounds crazy, but we have all the residents do that. It's a very good learning device. You know, either practice on a bear or an apple. Oh. Here we see the dangers of making mistakes about differences between B and P under certain circumstances. So we see one of the dangers there, which is when you are paying too much attention to categories, you can't differentiate two facts that fall within the same category. Next example. Remember back at various points of anxiety during exams and such back when, where there was a world of difference between getting a 65 on a test and a 66 on a test. Not particularly different, but because there's this boundary drawn there between passing and failing, there is this dramatic differentiating we make. When you put up boundaries, you have trouble seeing how similar things are on either side of it. Next example, one additional problem that you get when you think categorically. And for this, everybody needs to turn over one of the pieces of paper, the paper you're going to hand in the questionnaire. And what I'm going to do is read you a series of phone numbers, and I want you to write them down as accurately as possible. Okay, ready. 243-2649, 650-3260, 2565779, 832-2449, 2-913-171, 2314-026, 593-2449, 7438-840. 831-5287. Okay, now what that exercise is, And no, that doesn't count towards the grade. What that will show, I'm sure, when in some obsessive burst of procrastination I actually look through the answers tonight, what it's going to show is the accuracy is going to tank the second you go from the phone number pattern. Call categorization. It comes right in the middle of the range of what counts as that color. People remember whether they saw that color or not far better than if you show them a color at the boundary. And people will show that as a function of what language they speak. Taking a continua and you break it into pieces because it's easier to deal with the facts. Another example of it, here we have four objects, and as drawn here, simply because we have categories to describe the first three, do one of those tests of show people a bunch of shapes, and they come back an hour later and ask them, have you seen the shape before? And people are going to be far more accurate with this than whether they saw this or not, because we don't have a word for it. We don't have a word that's at all sort of analytical or some squiggly whatever. We don't have a clear-cut category. Thinking in categories makes it easier for us to remember stuff. And it makes it easier for us to evaluate stuff. So that's a classic sort of response that we have cognitively to complicated things. But there's a bunch of problems with categorical thinking. First example. And first one you can see from a realm of language differences in that not only is there a continuum of infinite number of wavelengths, there's a continua of sounds that humans can make. And different languages draw boundaries at different points as to what count as similar sounds or different sounds. There's like two different TH sounds in English, which apparently we're not very good at hearing, but there's other ones we are. And that will affect your ability to remember stuff, what word it was, depending on whether it is on a grammatically different boundary, whether it is a sound that sounds different to you or not. Example of this. Apparently, in Finnish, people do not differentiate between the sound of a B and the sound of a P, whereas we have no trouble with that. But people from Finland do not make that differentiation, and I discovered this one day a number of years ago, where for reasons I don't even understand, I found myself needing to take testicular biopsies on baboons. Not having sort of learned that in junior high how you do that, I called up this guy, urology, at the med school, who happened to be Finnish, and I explained to him what I wanted to do, and he sort of took me through the paces and told me what thingy I needed to buy and that sort of stuff and holiday packages of those where you can get a dozen and sort of telling me how to do that. And once we went through, he said, what I want you to do, the thing to do at this point is get some practice. I want you to practice on a bear. I said, what? He said, yeah, practice on a bear. And I said, are you kidding me? He said, I know it sounds crazy, but we have all the residents do that. It's a very good learning device. You know, either practice on a bear or an apple. Oh, here we see the dangers of making mistakes about differences between B and P under certain circumstances. So we see one of the dangers there, which is when you are paying too much attention to categories, you can't differentiate two facts that fall within the same category. Next example. Remember back at various points of anxiety during exams and such back when, where there was a world of difference between getting a 65 on a test and a 66 on a test. Not particularly different, but because there's this boundary drawn there between passing and failing, there is this dramatic differentiating we make. When you put up boundaries, you have trouble seeing how similar things are on either side of it. Next example, one additional problem that you get when you think categorically. And for this, everybody needs to turn over one of the pieces of paper, the paper you're going to hand in the questionnaire. And what I'm going to do is read you a series of phone numbers, and I want you to write them down as accurately as possible. Okay, ready. 243-2649, 650-3260, 2565779, 832-2449, 2-913-171, 2314-026, 593-2449, 7438-840. 831-5287. Okay, now what that exercise is, And no, that doesn't count towards the grade. What that will show, I'm sure, when in some obsessive burst of procrastination I actually look through the answers tonight, what it's going to show is the accuracy is going to tank the second you go from the phone number pattern. These color categorization, it comes right in the middle of the range of what counts as that color. People remember whether they saw that color or not far better than if you show them a color at the boundary. And people will show that as a function of what language they speak. Taking a continua and you break it into pieces because it's easier to deal with the facts. Another example of it, here we have four objects, and as drawn here, simply because we have categories to describe the first three, do one of those tests of show people a bunch of shapes and they come back an hour later and ask them, have you seen the shape before? And people are going to be far more accurate with this than whether they saw this or not, because we don't have a word for it. We don't have a word that's at all sort of analytical or some squiggly whatever. We don't have a clear-cut category. Thinking in categories makes it easier for us to remember stuff, and it makes it easier for us to evaluate stuff. So that's a classic sort of response that we have cognitively to complicated things. But there's a bunch of problems with categorical thinking. First example, and first one you can see from a realm of language differences, in that not only is there a continua of infinite number of wavelengths, there's a continua of sounds that humans can make. And different languages draw boundaries at different points as to what count as similar sounds or different sounds. There's like two different TH sounds in English, which apparently we're not very good at hearing, but there's other ones we are. And that will affect your ability to remember stuff, what word it was, depending on whether it is on a grammatically different boundary, whether it is a sound that sounds different to you or not. Example of this. Apparently, in Finnish, people do not differentiate between the sound of a B and the sound of a P. Whereas we have no trouble with that. But people from Finland do not make that differentiation. And I discovered this one day a number of years ago, where for reasons I don't even understand, I found myself needing to take testicular biopsies on baboons. Not having sort of learned that in junior high how you do that, I called up this guy, urology, at the med school, who happened